So if you guys can help me, welcome. We got a couple of special musical guests. They're going to come join me on this next song. Mr. John Sanford on the tenor saxophone. Mr. Kevin C. on the trumpet. And Mr. Luke Wethington on the alto saxophone. Oh, gotcha. Should we do that after this or before this? Okay. But before we do that, our resident pianist, Miss Laura Mastar, is going to read our scripture for us.
You have heard that it was said, eye for eye and tooth for tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So now we're going to perform a piece that I wrote. It's part of a series, a suite that I'm writing. It's a violence prevention suite. And this was the first song I composed for the suite. It's in honor of the Emmanuel Church in Charleston, South Carolina, that was attacked a couple of years ago, and how that community healed and how the church responded to the attack is all kind of chronicled in the song. You'll first hear kind of a setting for the church itself, and then we'll chronicle a version of the attack, and then how the church healed after that. So this tune is entitled Emmanuel.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Oh my God, no, I have your actual words.
Breathe. Everyone. Wow. And where I grew up, drummers couldn't read music.
I still true.
How's that saying?
Could have never invited them.
And yet, here you compose this. Wow, what an incredible job.
Thank you.
What possessed you to undertake the project?
Like I said, the first song that I guess the tipping point or whatever was that attack on Emmanuel Church. But there were lots of things leading up to that, lots of things going on where all these different acts of violence that I was noticing, as we all noticed, that was, you know, one group attacking another group. And somehow in there, we're all trying to figure out why, we're all trying to decipher how to move forward, how to do all that. And something about that particular incident was like, for me, kind of like the last straw of like, all right, I want to actually try and answer this question. Like, why is this stuff happening, and how do you make it better? So I started, I kind of did two things. First of all, I just needed to, as a musician, as an artist, that you got to figure out how to express these feelings somehow with your art. So I first started just writing my feelings about the event, and then I started reading more about how the church itself forgave their attacker, and how the entire community of Charleston rallied around the church, and how the church now is stronger than ever. And it actually led to a lot of other things, like some removing of some hurtful Confederate symbols and stuff around the state of Southern California. South Carolina.
One of those other states.
SC. USC. But then I started reading more. I wanted to research more about how all that worked, and that's when I came to kind of the conclusion that it's my belief that we're all built with this. Is why it's called survival instinct. We're built with all of these instincts, these prime movers, right? The things that make us actually get up out of bed in the morning. Some of us have better prime movers than others when it comes to getting out of bed in the morning. But and things like, you know, we have instincts to tell us to eat. And we have, you're right, and that instinct is built in us so that we don't starve to death. Yet we now live in a culture where there's no, like, at least most people we know don't have to worry about that. And we had to teach ourselves how to, like, I had to teach myself to go, you know what? I actually do not have to eat that jelly donut, because I promise you I'm not going to starve to death. I'm just going to leave that donut alone. And it took me a while. We had to educate ourselves. We actually don't need to eat as much as our bodies like to tell us. Like, we've got to be eating all the time or we're going to starve. Same thing happens, like, you know, we have instinct to have kids, right? We have to keep making more humans, because there was a time when we weren't sure how many humans we were going to have. Well, now we've got plenty of the humans, right? But you can't tell a 15-year-old boy, like, you know, you don't have to worry about that anymore. It's all boy. Right. Right. It's built in us. We have to educate ourselves on how to handle these instincts that we don't quite need as much as we used to. And this is one of them. It's the instinct that we all have to stick together. And we do have to stick together. But as the world has gotten bigger, and as we've gotten more and more connected, the larger these groups become, the more corrupt they become, the more distance we have between us. And that, in my research, that is the biggest problem. We used to function in small groups in communities, like this church or like Hapeville. And now as we try to go farther and farther out, like on Facebook, if you're gonna fight with your friends about any number of topics, we start to become dehumanizing. We will dehumanize another side, another pack, another group, because our side has to win. All of us have it in us that our sports team has to win, our political party has to win, our religion has to be right, we eat the best food, I know what the best barbecue is. You cannot convince me otherwise, right? We all have that built in us.
Barbecue. kitchen right down the street.
That's it, right down the street. But there are things we can do. The first thing is to recognize that if the more we can keep our groups smaller, and when I say keep our groups smaller, I mean focus on one-on-one contact, right? Have you ever asked yourself why Jesus never wrote any of the books of the Bible? Like, why didn't Jesus write all this stuff down and pass it out as often as he could, right?
He was an artist. He was performing.
Well, he was connecting one-on-one. He wanted to speak to people, right? He could have written all this out and said, here, you guys go do this yourself, right?
Text it.
Right. So instead, he changed the world by talking to a very small group of people and then let that kind of grow. And one of the things that our church is facing with right now is the whole United Methodist Church as a large thing, right? And most of the people in this thing don't know us personally. We don't know them personally. And therein lies one of the problems that's happening. And I know there's lots of things about the how a church works as to why we need to be a big thing. But at the same time, the more we can scale it down to one-on-one relationships, right? We will break down the bigger barriers, the racial barriers, the religious barriers, the political barriers, these larger groups that actually make us more evil and we don't even realize that it's happened.
Wow. Well, I noticed in the specifics on a couple of things I wanted to ask about. There was a silence.
Mm-hmm.
And was that 9 shots?
That was 9. Very good.
For the 9 people that died.
Yes, good catch. Yeah.
And then what about the speed up at the end? I thought you were on acid or something. Oh, no, the drummer's going wild!
It is not the first time I've sped a piece up, but this is the first time it was intentional. that's all about the pain and the suffering that happens right after that. And then the eventual healing through the church. It starts sad and angry. They're all playing at the same time and talking at the same time. And slowly through that, I picture them coming back to church every Sunday and slowly but surely healing from it and eventually turning it around into a positive thing because, like I said, the whole community of Charleston gathered around that church. And actually, I think ended up doing the exact opposite of what that person who, he wanted to start a race war, and he wanted to divide people in that community, and he actually did the opposite. They pulled together. And so that's why the end is them healing through the church.
And then, I asked you about the scripture for this morning that Laura read, and you picked 2 of them from Matthew. One is titled The Eye for an Eye, mm-hmm. and the other one is Love Your Enemies.
Right.
How did those two resonate with you for this project?
They resonated because one of the other things that's tricky about this is that without even really knowing it's happening to you, you are instantly judging someone on the other side of whatever fence it is, right? It can be, like I said, it can be religious, it can be racial, it can be gender, it can be sexual preference, all of that stuff. You have to fight against creating a boundary there. And so one of the ways that I think Jesus does a great job here of saying is like, that shouldn't matter. And one of the more important pieces of things about the pieces that I wrote, is I specifically wanted to write stuff in support of people who don't look like me, who maybe don't think like I think, who don't act like me. So a lot of the pieces are going to be things that we don't associate with being a white heterosexual male, right? So I want to try and reach out and support anyone who is not like me. And I think that's a lot of what Jesus is saying here in terms of the second half if you are only worried about taking care of your own group, right? And you say, well, we're going to love ourselves and if somebody's different from us, then some way they actually become an enemy. And we don't think that at the time, but they become an enemy. They become somebody that we feel differently from and therefore must be different. And they don't belong to our group. They don't belong to our pack. And if they don't belong to our pack in a small way, like we're a different political party or or we're a different race, or we're from a different town, I believe that that grows and grows. And although it might not make any of us do something drastic, it's like the butterfly effect. And the more you show that there's a huge divide between us, the larger that grows until somebody does something drastic and causes harm, and then we all get back together and say, why did this happen? And then 2 days later, we're arguing with each other or on Facebook or honking a horn to somebody in the car in front of us, and then it builds and builds and builds. So I think he kind of lays out very clearly that even, and also I picked this because of the Emmanuel Church thing. They forgave their attacker. They didn't hang on to that, which is why I think they healed so quickly.
So I don't know if y'all heard it in the prayer today. I use the term disagree productively. I've also used the phrase to disagree without being disagreeable. But that concept of having differences but not letting it rule the day, not let it dominate, not let it define who you are in your relationship with other people is cool. I didn't realize that when I picked that out for the prayer. So we've got another song that you're about to do, and this one is called Pulse. Why don't you tee that up for us and tell us about it?
Sure. Another attack that happened within this same span of time that I was writing this was when the nightclub down in Orlando, Florida got attacked. And there's a couple different group things there. One is obviously the nightclub was a gay nightclub, and so many people that I know personally were just devastated by that and felt attacked, and everyone was worried. And the second thing is that the guy who attacked that club had actually nothing to do with the Islamic State. He just somewhere along the way decided that he belonged to them and he had to fight for them. And they didn't know who he was. They had no connection with them, but he picked a group and then started fighting for them. And so one of the things I wanted to write about was how similar we all are, and, you know, just like so many other minority groups are still fighting to just be thought of as equal, right? Women are still trying to be thought of, you know, fighting hard to be thought of as equal to men. And when it comes to sexuality, this is a fairly new one, you know, in terms of how long, you know, our species has been fighting to realize that we're all the same. And so for this, I wanted to point out that although someone's sexual preference might be different than yours, that really means absolutely nothing at all. We're all the exact same person. So I chose this song, obviously The Pulse is the name of the club, but the song is written with 7 beats. You don't need to know that. You need to know it. But it's written with 7 beats. And it's 7 beats because there are 7 colors of the rainbow. And the LGBT flag is inspired by the rainbow. I think the regular LGBT flag only has 6 colors. So I wrote it in 7. But most importantly, although there are 7 beats to go by quickly, you'll only be able to feel 4 of them. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And the reason that's important is because most of the music that we all listen to, all the stuff we play today, has 4 pulses. So someone that has 7 beats can still have 4 pulses, i.e. you can seem different on the outside, but when in actuality our heartbeat, our hearts are all exactly the same. So that's represented in the song.
Wow. I didn't know I was going to get a music lesson. I appreciate it.
Sorry about that.
is that 7-4 or 7?
Yeah, 7-4.
Wow. So during this last song, we'll also be passing the plate. And I wanted to make sure everyone understood the reason behind that. So this isn't paying for the musicians. We've already done that in the church. But what this is for is to fund the project. And tell us a little bit about why, how the project is being funded, in what way.
Sure. Well, when I started writing this stuff and I realized that the biggest thing I wanted to do was get it out to as many people as possible. I wanted to be able to you know, make CDs and hand them out to people, donate them to churches and schools, and put it up on as many online outlets as possible. And then in the process of thinking that through, I wanted to make the clear decision that, see, usually when you make a recording as an artist, you put up a bunch of money to have it recorded, and then you sell the product so that you make your money back, and then you eventually make a profit. I don't want to make a profit off this. I don't want to collect a single dime off of this. I don't want the idea that these people have suffered to somehow bring me any money. That said, I still have to pay for the recording studio. I still have to pay a company to press the CDs. And the more of them I can press, the more of them I can hand out. And so basically, I'm raising funds to cover the cost of the recording time, and to cover the cost to have the CDs printed and duplicated and all that.
Okay. So there is, we'll pass the plate, but there's also a GoFundMe page that's up for this purposes. I put it on our website today. If you go under About and Music, at the very bottom, there's a picture and a link that you can click there. Or you can just go to GoFundMe and search for Justin Barnes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's on our Facebook page also. Ready?
Yes, sir.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you for letting me.
Thank you for trusting us as the first place for a live performance of this.
That's right.
We'll be right back.
you're like what you see here today and you're a visitor and like to join our congregation here, I'll visit with you after the service outside. But for now, I receive this as your benediction. Did we pass the plate?
We'll put it out there. Y'all just feel free. We'll put the plate out there.
We'll put the plate right outside afterwards. Thank you. So now receive this as your benediction. Blessed are you, Lord our God, ruler of the world, who rewards the undeserving with goodness, and who has rewarded us with all goodness. May the God who rewards you with all goodness do so forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
We might have